Krishnal, please tell me something about yourself.
Sir, my name is Krishna Kumar Singh. Sir, mm-hmm. I was born and brought up in Udaipur only. I did my schooling in Udaipur. Mm-hmm. Then I went to MNIT Jaipur. I pursued a master's in BTech in chemical engineering. Mm-hmm. After that, I worked for 1 year in Reliance Industries. Mm-hmm. Now, presently, I'm working in SBI. My father is retired from IFFDC, and my mother is a housewife.
Okay. Krishnan, what I'm trying to understand is you did your chemical engineering, BTech in chemical engineering in the year 2015. Yes, then you worked some time for Reliance Industry operations sector, I think. Yes?
Yes, sir. Panel operations.
Yes. Then you joined SBI as a probationary officer. Now, yes, why do you want to get into NABARD?
Sir, NABARD as an organization is engaged both in policy making and implementation work. And also, it's a regulatory body. Mm-hmm. And I see working in NABARD as more challenging and satisfying. Mm-hmm. Because it is involved in rural and agriculture development, which in itself is a challenging sector. Like all our government policies and, you know, the primary focus of our government is on agriculture sector only. Mm-hmm. And I as an individual wants to work for this organization so that I can contribute to the sector that is really important for our country.
Okay, fair enough. Krishnan, can you take me through that? What are those applications of chemical engineering that we can use in the agricultural sector? Any three applications?
So applications like, sir, in chemical engineering, we had learned about environmental impact assessments, mm-hmm. like how we can substantiate our knowledge and help in conserving our environment. Mm-hmm. For example, like stubble burning. If mm-hmm. if we can tell the farmers that it is very harmful to environment in a long run, and if they do not indulge in stubble burning, and which can be used for forming organic fertilizers, it will be helpful for them and as well as for the environment. Mm-hmm. Then another applications like we also learned about rainwater harvesting systems, mm-hmm. which can be used because 66% of our agriculture is rain-fed agriculture. And in such areas, there is much need of these rainwater harvesting systems, which we can help them build. And third application that we can help as a chemical engineer is, like we also learned about developing plants and machineries. There was a subject there where we learned about how to start your own work or our own organization and make it into manufacturing sector. And so we can help them to form an SHG or FPO or a small MSME so that it can help in increasing their income.
Okay. Fair enough. Have you heard of the twin balance sheet problem?
Yes, sir. That we are facing currently in our economy. Twin balance sheet is like there are less savings with the banks. No, the banks has the savings, but they are not lending to the corporate sectors. Mm-hmm. And the corporate sectors themselves, they do not have that much of profit, or their balance sheet is not that good so that they can avail loans from the banks.
Can you tell me any three measures that can be taken or that has been taken in the past by the governing authority to solve this problem?
The twin balance sheet problem, like they have reduced repo rates. RBI has reduced the repo rate so that to encourage the banks to give loans to the companies, and the government is planning to include to invest more in long-term infrastructure project so that they can get income in a longer run.
Any agency has been established to cater to twin balance sheet problem? Are you aware about it?
Insolvency and bankruptcy board has been set up. Okay. IBC.
Mm-hmm. What else?
I'm not sure about that.
Okay. Not a problem. My next question is, let us say that you as a person has been appointed to manage or supervise the default risk of a banking system, of a bank or of a banking system. And you have to use certain metrics or certain models to predict the future default of an individual or a client, let's say, let's talk about any client, XYZ client, what are some of the metrics, what are some of the parameters that you would look upon?
I would look upon it's his or her credit score, mm-hmm. like how his credit history has been prior to the prior coming to us, mm-hmm. Whether he has paid his past loans or mm-hmm. he has defaulted somewhere.
Okay, one and, is credit history. What else?
Yes, and I would also see their balance sheet. I mean, yeah. what is the net profit they are showing?
Anything specific in the balance sheet, Krishnan?
Their assets and liabilities. I mean, what are their assets and liabilities?
Okay.
And how much profit they have, and what is their net worth at present?
Okay. Anything specific to debt that we can check? Any ratio specific thing?
We can check.
Have you heard of debt equity ratio?
Debt equity ratio. Yes, I've heard.
Okay.
How much debt they have?
Right. Do you know the concept of sustainable development?
Yes, a sustainable development. It's a concept.
No, that's not my question. I'm just asking yes, you. Can yes, you throw sir. Some light on the triple bottom line approach of sustainability?
Triple bottom line.
Yes.
I'm sorry, sir. I have not heard about this.
Okay, not a problem. One more question from my side. Can you tell me what are the measures taken by NABARD with respect to achievement of sustainable development goals that UN has issued in the year 2015? What are the measures being taken by NABARD?
Sir, NABARD is our implementing agency of the funds that we have, adaptation fund and green climate fund. Mm-hmm. So it is disbursing loan in this regard to help in climate conservation.
Mm-hmm.
For example, we have in RIDF also, they have been promoting rainwater harvesting systems and rural connectivity. And
can you specifically make a connection with like what are the measures taken and which sustainable development goal they are catering to? Like one you said about climate.
Yes, sir.
Right. So which sustainable development goal it is being targeted?
So goal number 17.
It relates to?
Sir, our climate conservation.
Are you sure that goal 17 is related to climate conservation?
Not exactly. I don't remember the number, but one of the goals is this only.
Good enough. Go ahead.
Please continue. So they have also helped in construction of Anganwadis to promote health of student to health of children and mothers. So okay. it helps. So this is also one of the goals of SDGs.
What is the name of the goal?
To remove malnutrition and promote health of children.
Are you sure this is one of the goals?
Yes, sir. I think so. Yes, sir.
Okay. Go ahead.
They have programs like dairy entrepreneurship development program, mm-hmm. and tribal development fund from which they help in promoting entrepreneurship. So this can help in the goal of removing poverty.
Okay. Fair enough. Now I could see that you have some, you have also earned certificates in NCC as well.
Yes, sir.
Can you tell me what is the relevance of NCC's logo's colors? There are several colors in the NCC logo. So can you just run me through the importance of such colors?
Sorry, sir. I don't know. I mean, what was the importance of the colors? Okay. There were three colors. Okay. I know. I remember the logo, but I don't know
no
the
problem.
Importance.
No problem. So that's all from my side. Over to you, Hansa, ma'am.
Yeah. Hello.
Hello. Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. Good afternoon.
Good afternoon, ma'am.
How are you? How are you?
I'm fine, ma'am.
All right. Okay. So Krishan, my first question would be, since you're from Rajasthan, right? Can you tell me something about the agricultural landscape in your state?
Ma'am, in Rajasthan, there are a dominant number of farmers who are engaged in primary production, like yeah, Rajasthan is largest producer in, of bajra and small millets. And well, the western side of Rajasthan, it's more desert area. So we are facing the problem of desertification and land degradation. But from eastern side, we receive water from Chambal River and one more tributary of Yamuna River. So we have ample amount of water in eastern side. So there are good producing districts of wheat, rice, and sugarcane and maize.
Okay. So what is the predominant soil that is found in your state?
Desert in arid soil, mm-hmm. mainly.
So, and what are the features of these soil?
Arid soil, ma'am, they don't have moisture in it, mm-hmm. so they are not conducive for agriculture purposes, mm-hmm. and they also leads to desertification and all. So yeah. We must contain them to their place only.
Okay, then how come a bajra is the highest if the land of the soil in Rajasthan is not suitable for most of the crops, right? If it has some of the leaching properties in it, then why do you think that Rajasthan is also the highest producer in bajra?
And bajra is it does not require the amount of water. I mean, the requirement of water for bajra is less than 50 centimeter. I mean, it can be practiced in an rain-fed area or where the availability of water is less. So from that help, I mean, we can have bajra.
Okay. Since you've also mentioned to Shubham sir in your previous questions that when he was asking about how your educational qualification is related to agriculture, right? So I noted that you've talked about rainwater harvesting system.
Yes, ma'am. Right?
So under that, can you differentiate between the micro catchment water harvesting and macro catchment water harvesting systems?
Well, micro catchment water harvesting systems are located in small places like a rooftop can be used as a micro catchment area. Whereas in watershed management, what we can do, we can use the local resource from where the catchment area or coming from the rainwater or from certain river is used for water harvesting.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So you also talked about some of the environmental assessments impact, right? Mm-hmm. Right. So my question here is, do you have any idea of some of the methods or the techniques that are being used in agriculture for the more sustainable development in the future? For example, in we look into the more of the ecological balance. Keeping in view ecological balance, okay? The new techniques which are used in agriculture, keeping in view the ecological balance and also the environment.
Ma'am, for example, which I mentioned earlier also, the stubble burning. I mean, the government is collecting the stubble from the farmers to make it into an organic manure, which can be used as a fertilizer. And farming techniques like in rice cultivation, intensive rice cultivation is followed, in which less water is used. So water wastage is reduced. And
but don't you think that when you grow intensive, they say that when you have an intensive rice cultivation, it basically degrades the soil after, right? So after years, then it's going to degrade the soil. Then is that a proper method of going forward in agriculture, looking into the ecological balance or looking into the present scenario of the environmental degradation that we are seeing at this moment?
Ma'am, we can practice multiple farming in that field. I mean, crop rotation can be practiced in the field so mm-hmm. that the overall quality of the soil doesn't degrade to such a level that it cannot be used in for further use in future.
Oh. Okay. All right. Another question that I have for you is, can you tell me some of the, have you heard about this organic farming, right?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So can you tell me then first organic state in India?
Ma'am, it's Sikkim. Okay. It is now 100% organic producing
right.
state in India.
So recently as well, there has been, they declared one union territory as 100% organic. Do you have any idea about it?
No, sorry, ma'am. I haven't heard about it.
No problem. Okay, so my last question for you is, Krishan, can you name at least three JI tags from Rajasthan.
One is from Kota Doria Saris from Kota. They make these beautiful saris with this special thread, Kota Doria. They name it, and it's those saris. And then one is the blue pottery from Jaipur. And I just remember only two.
All right, no problem, no problem. All right, Krishan, that's all from my side. Over to you, Mansi, ma'am, for the...
Hi, Krishan, am I audible?
Yes, ma'am, good afternoon, ma'am.
Good afternoon, and how is your interview going till now?
Ma'am, fine, I guess.
So, Krishan, my first question to you is that you come from a technology background, right? So, I believe that you must be aware of a term called fintech.
Fintech?
Yes.
Financial technology
system. Yes. So, could you cite any three recent fintech trends that can be used to solve problems of Indian agriculture?
Financial technologies. Online banking.
Okay. So you have worked at SBI. Could you cite any example?
Yes, ma'am. Like in terms of the program that the government runs, like Pradhan Mantri Jan Dhan Yojana, it has helped them a lot. I mean, receiving subsidies from the government directly into their bank accounts. And so they don't have to, I mean, wait in the long queues and to the mediators who used to disburse them the money. Now they just go to the bank and they just print their passbooks and they can see that whether they have received the money or not.
I'm asking in terms of SBI. So any program that SBI has undertaken to promote online banking or mobile banking?
Yes, ma'am. Our YONO digital platform is there. They are promoting it to the villagers and all. And now through that platform only KCCs are being given to the farmers.
So, since we are talking about YONO, have you heard of a term called neo banking? Neo banking.
No, ma'am.
That is perfectly fine. So you were talking to Shubham sir about the twin balance sheet problem, I believe.
Yes, ma'am.
So when this term twin balance sheet came out, an extension of it was also becoming popular, which was called four balance sheet problem. So could you tell me that which are the four balance sheets which are being talked about here?
Sorry, ma'am, I'm not aware about this also.
That's perfectly fine. So since you're going to be working for a banking institution, if you get into NABARD, could you cite any three major problems of Indian banking sector and ways to counter them?
Indian banking sectors, one of the major problem is NPAs. Obviously, I mean they are much more in public sector banks than private sector banks. So we must have due diligence in disbursement of the loans. I mean, we must ensure properly to whom we are giving the loan and whether he has the amount of worth that he can return back the loan or whether he's investing the money into the right direction for which we are giving. And second is we have a lot of savings, but they're not going into financial systems. Like for example, people have savings with their banks, but they're not investing in markets or in equity so that it can come into our economic system and it can help our country to grow. And third is the banks that especially public sector banks are facing is the problem of a large amount of footfall. Actually, the number of customers are more as compared to private sector banks. And so the amount of manforce that the public sector banks has that cannot cater to the problems of every individual. So customer satisfaction is not there in public sector banks as I have experienced myself. So
since you talked about high footfall in public sector banks, why do you think there is more trust placed by people in public sector banks and why private banks are not able to catch up?
Ma'am, because major government policies and programs are run through our public sector banks only, and they are backed by the government. So there is the general trend in the minds of the people that they are too big to fail. So they put their entire trust on public sector banks only. Whereas in private sector banks, they do fear sometimes, like they charge hefty amounts for such transaction that they even do not commit. So they have to keep minimum balance and all. So they do not go to the private sector banks and they stay with us. So this is one of the reasons that we have the highest footfall.
You just mentioned about the credit worthiness of borrowers, right? So do you think there is a measure by which we can measure the credit worthiness? Like there is a popular measure. How can you assess if someone is credit worthy or not? Is there some kind of score?
CIBIL scores there, ma'am. We do check their CIBIL scores. Okay. By their PAN card and all, we see their credit history, whether they have defaulted prior to taking loan from us or they have any such other default in past that they have committed or whether it was settled or not. So as per the CIBIL score, we decide the interest rate at which we can give them the loans.
Okay, good enough. So in relation to this concept only of credit worthiness, have you heard of a term called account aggregator?
Account aggregator, no, ma'am. Yeah. I'm not.
That's perfectly fine. Okay, moving ahead to my next question. Are you aware of the concept called regulatory forbearance?
Regulatory forbearance, no, ma'am.
That's fine. Let's move ahead to the next question. So, what is your take on India's stance on RCEP?
Regional Comprehensive Economic Partnership. Yes, ma'am. Ma'am, actually, we are a major service exporter, and RCEP only like focuses mainly on manufacturing industries, and in manufacturing sector we are still lagging behind. From the countries which are included in RCEP. So if we allow Chinese companies to get into a market at less prices, with the less amount of tax and all, it can hurt our internal manufacturing industries, which are not up to the level so that they can compete with the global big players. So in RCEP, I do feel that service export should also be included so that we can compete in a balanced way. Otherwise, we'll be in a losing position.
So do you think there are any costs India would have to face by not joining RCEP?
Yes, ma'am, because in this globalized world, we need to have such partnerships with the countries that are around us to have this healthy relationships with them, because Atmanirbharta that was promoted at the time of COVID-19. It can be good up to a point, certain point only. We cannot produce anything and everything in our country. We need something from outside, and that can be a resource from outside, and we can use it to form new things in our country, to manufacture in our country. So we do need to have such partnerships so that we can we can get the benefit of economies of scale.
Okay, fair enough. My next question to you is regarding a regulation that RBI came up with. So RBI came up with a proposal and it said that a company should open current account into a bank, only into a bank who has been a lender to that particular company, not in any other bank. So could you tell me the reasons behind this regulation?
Yes, ma'am. Because we also say these things to our borrowers, like you cannot open current account to any other banks, because ma'am, if we do give them the credit to produce a product that they're manufacturing in their company, and if they receive a order from outside and they're exporting their material. So if they are not giving the account number of our bank and they are depositing the money to the current account of the other bank, it can remove the money from our banking channel and they can use for something else. We won't get to know like they are receiving the money from the order that we had given the money for which we have given the money. So whether they are receiving the money or not. So we ask them to close all such current accounts and receive all their money to our current account only, so that we can keep a check on like how much funds they are getting back and how much repayment they are doing to us and where they are investing all their money.
Basically tracking their funds.
Tracking their funds. Yes.
So a recent internal working group of RBI recommended that large conglomerates should be allowed to enter Indian banking sector, as well as large sized NBFCs should be converted into banks. So what do you think about this? And what do you think its impact can be on rural economy? Is it going to be beneficial for it, or it can harm it?
Ma'am, having more number of options can obviously help customers. I mean, if an NBFC or a big corporate group comes to in the banking sector, I mean, they will obviously give some benefits, or they'll have higher current account, less current account rates, or higher saving rates, or higher rates on FD. So customers will get more options in the market. So it will be helpful in that regard. But on the other hand, like big private players can also, diversion of funds can be there. I mean, acquiring funds from the public and using for their own benefit. So regulation would be of prime importance if such banks comes under the scenario.
So as you know that we have been witnessing a pandemic. So in relation to that, have you heard of a term called K-shaped recovery?
No, ma'am. Sorry, I have not heard of it.
Okay. Not a problem. So this question is in relation to one of India's neighboring country, which is being expected to surpass India's income in the current year. So can you tell me which is the country I'm talking about?
Bangladesh.
Yes. And could you tell me some lessons that India can learn from Bangladesh's economic growth in recent years?
Ma'am, their economic growth was basically led by Grameen Bank, how they provided loans to the people. And they generated income, sustainable source of income. And we can really learn from their economic model. How did this happen? I mean, giving loans to the people, and they generated sustainable income for a longer run. And they were able to repay the previous loans and were able to take new loans from the bank without failing the bank. I mean, without increasing their NPAs. So a good credit culture in Bangladesh and among the people is really helpful for the economy and for the country in a longer run. I mean, that can be a lesson that we can learn from them.
Okay, so working in a bank, have you heard of a term called tokenization?
Tokenization of currency, ma'am. I've heard about it, but ma'am, I'm not sure what it is.
That's perfectly fine. So this is going to be my last question to you, Krishan. Have you heard about Swamitva and Swanidhi schemes of government? And could you tell me the objectives of these two schemes?
Ma'am, Swanidhi scheme, it's a scheme giving loans to the street vendors, 10,000 rupees. Primarily, if he repays the loan in time, it can be extended to 20,000 rupees. And it's for like self-employment and to help them in the time of pandemic that we had. So this is the main objective of Swanidhi scheme.
And what about Swamitva?
Swamitva, I'm not sure about it.
So I think that would be all from my side, and all the best. Over